It's a long way back to you people. I think I'll have to do the service from right here so it actually looks like there's people here for the... Anyway, good morning. Welcome to the second Sunday after Pentecost here at Our Savior's. The second Sunday after Pentecost on this Memorial Day weekend, you'll hear some elements of Memorial Day throughout the service this morning. I'm glad you're here. It's better here because you are here, whether you're here in person or you're watching on YouTube or on television. It is good to have you here. Connect with us. If you're here, use the little brown books to connect and let us know you were here. If you have any ministry needs, you can talk to us face-to-face. That often works. Or call or use social media any way that you can connect with us so that we can connect with you and be in ministry where you are, where you need it. So we want to be here for each other as God's people, because together we serve a God who answers prayer. Not just prayers for an insider group, but prayers for from the entire world. The prayer of the outsider is just as important as the prayer of the insider. We'll hear that in the story from the gospel this morning. The attentive nature of our God is evident as God comes to us again and again as we share God's word and as we share in the Lord's Supper. And the psalm this morning reminds us to ascribe to the Lord the honor due God's name. Bring offerings and enter the courts of the Lord. Well, that's what we're here to do today. Our service this morning is slightly different, simplified for Memorial Day. One change from the bulletin. The prayer of the day comes just before our song of faith today. That song will be, when we sing "This Is My Song," we'll have already done the prayer of the day. So watch for that change in the bulletin there. Otherwise, rise with me as we join in singing "My Eyes Have Seen the Glory." If you need the music, that's 890. The words will be on the screen. We begin with a confession. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, abounding in steadfast love toward us, healing the sick, raising the dead, showering us with every good gift. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Just and gracious God, We come to you for healing and life. Our sins hurt others and diminish us. We confess them to you. Our lives bear the scars of sin. We bring these also to you. Show us your mercy, O God. Bind up our wounds. Forgive our sins and free us to love for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The Apostle Paul assures us, when we were dead in our trespasses, God made us alive together with Christ, nailing the record of our sins to the cross. Jesus says to you, your sins are forgiven. Be at peace and tell everyone how much God has done for you. Amen. So then the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Join with me in the prayer of the day. Merciful Lord God, we do not presume to come before you trusting in our own righteousness, but in your great and abundant mercies. Revive our faith, we pray, heal our bodies, and mend our communities, that we may evermore dwell in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Our next faith song, This Is My Song, 881 for the music. Again, the words will be on the screen.
Today's reading will be from the Psalm 96, verses 1 through 9. Please read responsively. The assembly's portion is in bold print. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless the name of the Lord. Proclaim God's salvation from day to day. Declare God's glory among the nations and God's wonders among all peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, more to be feared than all gods. Declare the glory of the Lord among the nations. As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols. But you, O Lord, have made the heavens. Majesty and magnificence are in your presence. Power and splendor are in your sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, you families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord honor and power. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due the holy name. Bring offerings and enter the courts of the Lord. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before the Lord, all the earth. Declare the Lord among the nations. Here ends the reading of the psalm. Word of God, word of life.
Rise with me, please, to prepare our hearts for the reading of this morning's gospel. The story in the words of Jesus, as Luke, the gospel writer, tells us from the 7th chapter of his biography of Jesus, beginning with verse 1. After Jesus had finished many sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum. A centurion there had a slave whom he valued highly and who was ill and close to death. When he heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders to him, asking him to come and heal his slave. When they came to Jesus, they appealed to him earnestly, saying, "He is worthy of having you do this for him, for he loves our people, and it is he who built our synagogue for us." And Jesus went with them. But when he was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to say to him, "Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you come under my roof. Therefore, I did not presume to come to you, but only speak the word, and let my servant be healed. For I also am a man set under authority with soldiers under me, and I say to one, 'Go,' and he goes, and to another, 'Come,' and he comes, and to my slave, 'Do this,' and the slave does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him, and turning to the crowd that followed him, he said, "I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith." Then those who had been sent returned to the house, and they found the slave in good health. The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. No children's sermon on the docket this morning, so everybody gets to listen to me. That'll teach ya. Faith of the nations. Sounds kind of grandiose, doesn't it? Faith of the nations. A little bit grand, a little bit, you know, pretentious, perhaps, but the thing is, that idea weaves its way all through our worship this morning. Faith of the nation, God of the nations. The faith on display in our story from Jesus this morning is a faith that is a little bit grand. It's a little bit amazing. This faith that is shown in a Roman centurion. There's some other amazing things that I noticed in this story this morning, and I want to dig around in there with you this morning and hold those amazing things up so that they can make a little mark in your brain, and you can kind of go, "Oh, let's see what I found." First off, this notion, when you got to transport yourself back 2,000 plus years to what life was like in Israel around the Sea of Galilee at the time that Jesus was wandering around. The place was ruled by the Romans. That was back when Rome was the power, you know, with Caesar and all of that business and, you know, centurions and the Roman army that was conquering the whole world. Israel had been conquered. They were allowed to do their own religious business, and they were allowed to do some of their own local business, but the nation was ruled by Rome. It would be as if, you know, it's hard to imagine what it would be like here if some foreign, what foreign country it could happen to be that would come and kind of take over everything. But in every community of any size at all, like Capernaum, which was kind of Jesus' sort of home base throughout his adult life. And Capernaum was a decent-sized town, a major fishing port, a lot of fish coming in and out of there. They had their own Roman garrison. There was a centurion, and a centurion is a Roman general kind of a guy that had 100 men, 100 Roman soldiers at his command. And they ran the place. They collected the taxes with the help of some Jewish folk. They protected the community from marauding bands of robbers. They were the police force. They were the governance force. They did everything. They built the roads. They built the aqueducts. They were in charge. And everybody hated them because they weren't Jewish. I don't know if you can wrap your brains about what it's like. I mean, try to imagine for a minute that that Cloquet used to be its own country. All right, and then somebody from St. Paul comes in and sends in the state police and a governor from the outside, and we're all Lutherans, okay? So if you were Jewish in the time of Jesus, you were just Jewish. And anybody from the outside you couldn't even eat with them. You couldn't go into their house. It would be just wrong and icky. Wronger and ickier than anything that is going on in the world today. Think of the most icky thing that's in the news. It was worse to hang out with people who weren't Jewish in Jesus' time. Much worse. And so your town is run by this outside force. And the natural thing, you just hated these people. They weren't like you. They were from a foreign country. They didn't worship the same God as you did. They ate funny food, and it was just icky and wrong and stinky. But this guy, this leader of this invading force living in Capernaum, the first thing that amazes me about this story is that Jesus listens to his needs. It doesn't matter that he's Roman. It doesn't matter that he's icky. It doesn't matter that he's stinky. It doesn't matter that he's wrong, completely wrong in every sense. Jesus listens to the need that he has. The second thing that amazes me about this story is that the Jewish authorities, who in every other town hated the Roman occupation, hated it. In some cases, they even fought against it. Little bands of guerrilla warfare going down all the time, always ambushing the Roman army. In Capernaum, they loved him. They loved this guy because he loved them. This is kind of weird. I mean, this Roman guy, who knows? We don't know his name. Why Luke and Matthew also tells the story don't tell us this guy's name. This is a big guy. They should name him. We don't know his name. We don't know where he's from, but he does something very amazing and unusual. He loves the people of Capernaum. He takes care of them like he's one of them. He builds their synagogue. He was supposed to build the public places. He was supposed to keep those safe, but he builds their worship space. There's been a recent archaeological dig in Capernaum, and they've discovered a couple of places that were probably this. One was a house, a pretty decent-sized house, which was probably the centurion's house, that then got turned into the synagogue, the Jewish worship and meeting place. And they think that was this place. He built their synagogue. He supported it. He loved them. Three amazing things already. He's respected deeply and even considered worthy by the civic and religious leaders of that community, and who hope then that Jesus will respond to his needs. And Jesus does. He listens. They say, he's worthy. Come on. Now, I'm not sure if that's why Jesus went, because of the religious leaders, or because he knew what was coming. Because the other amazing thing about this centurion, this guy, this outsider, this stinky outsider dude, was he knew who Jesus was. He knew what Jesus could do. And he knew how he could do it. He knew that Jesus could heal his servant, his slave, whom he loved. And in those days, too, I mean, that's a sort of a small little other amazing piece. This guy loved his slaves. And slavery is a long way from our experience, but it's more than just, you know, liking your hired help. This guy loved his slaves. Anyway, so Jesus knows what's coming with this. He knows how Jesus' authority really functions, this centurion, apparently even better than the so-called people of God who come on his behalf. He knows what Jesus can do. In so many of the other healing stories, Jesus has to come right up and get up close and personal. You know, it's like, I got to touch you. And a couple of times he had to repeat himself, you know, stick his fingers in people's ears. And I mean, most of the time Jesus' healings were laying hands on, and, you know, he had to get right in there and do the work. But the centurion knows, and this is amazing that it's the centurion who knows this, the foreigner, the stinky guy, knows that all Jesus has to do is, if from a distance, is go, all you'd have to do is say the word, just say the word, and my servant will be healed. Centurion knows that it's difficult for Jesus to come into his house, so he doesn't have to do it. The centurion knows that it may be even difficult to have a face-to-face conversation with him, so he sends friends in to have the conversation. You don't have to come, Jesus. I know. It's okay. I'm not worthy. And that's weird, too. That's an amazing, weird thing. I mean, a centurion is like, he's boss man. You know, cha-ching, cha-ching, swords and frills and armor and wah! I'm not worthy, this guy says. I'm not worthy. Don't come. Just say the word. That's all it'll take. Amazing faith. Amazing faith. And the other interesting thing about this little story, too, we don't hear how what Jesus did. We don't know if he waved his hands or stood on one leg or he did it. All we know is that they had the conversation. He was amazed. His friends go home, and the servant's already healed. The slave is already healed. Amazing stuff. Now, here's what all of that amazing stuff soaked around in my brain all week and for the past month as I've been looking at this, and it fizzed around in there a little bit like Alka-Seltzer in water, and it kind of bubbled to the surface some interesting things that I think we can take home from this. Under the power that made this happen, the amazing power of the reality of Jesus in the world for the nations is faith, hope, and love all wrapped up together. It's like the promise of the Holy Spirit that we will get faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is, yeah, love. Okay, let's do that again. Faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is, there, I knew you could do it. All right, so that's one of the amazing things of this piece, is the story is that it all, that faith, hope, and love gets all wadded together in this story. It's almost like last week, those of you who were here last week and was talking about the Trinity, you know how we know how God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and that three business. It's almost like that three business is at work and at play in this faith, hope, and love in this story. And maybe in our lives. Faith, hope, and love are nearly one, maybe a little bit like the Trinity that we explored last week. And then it's in its real and authentic form. It's not just so much words. It's not just these sort of neat, sort of religious ideas. Faith, hope, and love in their authentic forms do real things in the world. Make real differences in real people's lives. And they don't conform to the ordinary. It's amazing stuff. It's unexpected. It's powerful beyond normal reason. I mean, even, you know, faith healers, you know, they have to get in there and wave their hands. My wife does amazing healing. She's a massage therapist. Some of you have paid her to do her amazing work. But she actually has to touch you in order for massage therapy to work. It's not magic, it's not a miracle, but it's amazing. But with Jesus, it's just from a distance even. It's like long distance. And he doesn't even have to say anything according to the way Luke tells the story. It's like, cool. And the guy's healed. And he's so, this guy's faith just such so touches Jesus. In its real, authentic form, hope, love, and faith don't conform to the ordinary. It's amazing. It's unexpected. Hope, faith, and love then transforms the relationships. This guy that everybody was supposed to hate, the love of that community, the faith, hope, and love that was already there. I hope you, in the story, it was already there. The community already had faith and hope and love in this centurion. The centurion already knew that Jesus could do something amazing. That faith, hope, and love had transformed that community into one that should have been an antagonistic. We're fighting against these Romans. The Romans hate us. They're all going to kill us. And don't, you know, keep your doors locked at night. Into a place of love and peace and cooperation and sharing. Faith, hope, and love does that. It makes a difference in your own heart so that you're ready to do faith, hope, and love with other people. And in the community together, it's like you listen. You pay attention, you care, and the world around becomes a better, hopeful, faithful, loving place. Hope, love, and faith transform relationships, even entire communities. Love, faith, and hope are for the world. Literally, for the nations. This is the faith, hope, and love of the nations. It's not just for, you know, a cute little group of Lutherans that are meeting together on Memorial Sunday. There are a few more people at first service. You're slightly, normally this service outnumbers first service, just so you know that. Not this week. Maybe we should have gone to one service this week. I don't. Anyway, but it's not, this isn't just for us. This faith, hope, and love that brought you in the door this morning is it's not supposed to just be, you know, oh, good, faith, hope, and love, faith, hope, and love. Aren't we sweet? Aren't we nice? Aren't we great? This faith, hope, and love is supposed to take that joy, that love, that peace, that strength out there, wherever you go tomorrow or this afternoon or next week or on into eternity. This is supposed to, this faith, hope, and love is supposed to grow out of us out there for the others. You know, of our mission statement. Faith, hope, and love are supposed to make a real difference in real people's lives. So with those pieces, some questions fizzled up in my brain too. If that's what faith, hope, and love are supposed to do in us, and that's what it did in this story with Jesus and the centurion and the people of Capernaum, so, what of me? What of me? Faith, hope, and love, are they supposed to? Can they? Is it possible for them to make that same kind of difference in my own heart? That I really care about you people? And I care about the others that I'll run into out on the street? And that we together will grow in faith, hope, and love. What about you? It's not just a story that we heard this morning. It's a reality being described. It's a truth. It's the way God works. It's the way God is. Faith, hope, and love burning in our souls, effervescing out of our very being. Can we allow that to flow? Too easily our sin goes, no, I'm fine. We'll just, okay, next song. Too easy, this. What we do turns into this little clubhouse thing that we do in the building and doesn't go anywhere else. It doesn't make a difference out there in the world. People don't know who you are. People don't see the faith, hope, and love pouring out of our pores. Too often our sin, our fear, whatever it is, gets in the way and blocks it. It's like, there's not enough of faith, hope, and love to go around, so I'm going to keep it. It's not the way God made it. There's an endless supply of faith, hope, and love for the nations. It begins in your own heart, my own heart, your own heart, and just boom, out into the rest of the world. That's what this story tells us. That's the reality of God in the world. Can we let our community, can we let our relationships, even our own hearts, be transformed by the same healing word that Jesus still speaks today? As he spoke it on the streets of Capernaum outside the centurion's home, can we still hear it? Can we still be amazing to Jesus? I think so. I think so. Because that's really the most amazingly grand thing about all of this, this faith of the nations. It's what the Holy Spirit does. It's what God does. It's what Jesus does. Faith, hope, love in you, in me, in us. That same faith that the story tells us about in the centurion, it's in us. Final question. Will it show? Another song for Memorial Day. God bless our native land. Begin with me this time to proclaim your faith, to assent, to say yes, to say what we believe together. We'll use this morning the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As long as we're up, let's pray. Let's pray together for the church, for those that we know are in need, and for all of God's creation. God of all the nations, there is no one like you in heaven above or on earth below. Remind us all that we are yours, that as believers we are your church. We may be of different denomination, we may express ourselves differently, but you send your hope, your love, your faith to build us up as your people. Help us live like it. Help us show it. Help us to help the world know your hope, your faith, your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, we ascribe to you, as our psalm suggests, glory and strength. Yes, you're incredible. We praise you for the glory of your creation. We see amazing things in the world around us. We ask that you would strengthen us to tend this creation as the gift and trust that it is. And when creation seems to rise up against us, we ask that you would give us peace and give us protection and help us rise up together to help one another in the midst of fire or flood or earthquake or volcano or strange happenings in the world around us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Ruler of all nations, in this land you brought together people from around the world. Over many different ages, over many different times, over many different migrations, you have helped us build this country. Continue to give us grace to receive new people who come, that we may show hospitality. And then as we travel and represent not only our country, but our faith as we go to other lands, help us be good guests, fully aware of the grace, the faith, hope, and love that are in our very being because of you. And then help us to accompany each other, either in this country or abroad, with your faith, your hope, your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Healing God, we know you heal. Our story this morning is just one example of how Jesus, when he was among us, healed those in need. We pray for all those who need to be made whole this day. We pray especially for those that we know need your healing touch. If they're grieving, if they're wounded, if they're sick, if they're facing illness, whatever the concerns that lie upon their hearts, if they're homeless, if they're hungry, not only give us the strength to turn them over to your care, but also give us the strength to minister to them, to be your hands and your feet and your hope and your faith and your love in their lives. We name before you in our hearts those whom we know need that healing power. Give us faith to trust that you are the presence that gives life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we remember today those who laid down their lives for others, especially in service of their country. Give us strength to live together as a faith community blessed by that service and sacrifice. Help us never forget. Help us be aware and be alive and be in service so that that sacrifice is not in vain, or that it's never ignored, or that it's never overlooked, or that it's never taken for granted. In humility and gentleness of spirit, help us to maintain the bonds of peace that so many died to protect. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your promise to hear us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Take some time, share that peace with one another. As we begin the process of gathering this morning's offering, thank you to all of you who support the work of our ministry here together, prayerfully with your own time and energy, or with your donations as well. Some of you noticed the graphic on the slides this morning and the poster on the back. As of last Tuesday, we were $115.25 away from being complete on the $20,000 matching. Last service, somebody wrote the check. So we're there. Woohoo! That'll generate another $20,000 in matching funds, which is really going to help us get through this year strong in ministry. So thank you for everyone who had anything at all to making that happen. Well, there'll be a formal announcement in coming weeks, but you heard it first. Anyway, New Horizons, our Christian preschool, just wrapped up another successful year this past Thursday. We had graduation for them here in this very spot. Good bunch of kids this year. We had 19 kids total that were a part of the program, and a bunch of those are moving on to pre-kindergarten or to kindergarten next year. It's a great year. Thanks for your support for the preschool this past year and your continued prayer support as we move forward into next year. We're really excited about going to all day next year and the new families that are going to be a part of things next year. So thank you so much. Notice that this is the last Sunday of two services for the summer. So next Sunday, worship is going to be at 9:30. Okay, so, and there's how many services? One. Okay, good. Now, see, the thing is, at first service, if they would have come late, that's, got there early, it's not a big deal. But if you people get here at 10:45, you'll have missed the whole thing. So what time's church next week? There, I know you can do this. All right. In a little more somber note, I just want to express the thanks for myself and my extended family. Many of you have sent us cards and given memorials and kept us in prayer after the death of my nephew. We'll be doing a family memorial for him probably around 4th of July weekend. But my brother wanted me to be sure to tell you and my sister-in-law that they could feel your prayers, and I could too, and it has made a difference in our family to know that you are our family of faith here supporting us in this time. So thank you very much for that. A note about if you have the chance, you're going to be around town tomorrow, try to make it down to the Veterans Memorial Park for the Memorial Day remembrances. It's a good thing for community to do together, so if you can. And an announcement too, and an invitation. This table is where we encounter Jesus in the world today. He comes to us in the bread and wine, and you are welcome here. You're welcome to this feast. You don't have to be Lutheran. You don't have to be a member here. If Jesus is here for you, please come. We'll be serving communion at two stations. There's gluten-free wafers at the left-hand station. There's grape juice in the inner ring of each wine tray. Please come. You are all welcome. Absolutely no exceptions. Just the way our Lord comes to us in real life, he comes to us that way in this feast as well. So you are welcome. If you would rise with me as we bless what you have offered this day, your gifts, your prayers, your love, please join with me in the offering prayer. God of mercy and grace, the eyes of all wait upon you, and you open your hand in blessing. Fill us with good things at your table, that we may come to the help of all in need, through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this to remember me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples, and now to us, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, the new agreement in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this to remember me." The grapes are an offer and a reminder to the youngest among us of the same story, the same faith, the same love, the same hope, the same grace. As all of us prepare to receive these reminders of Jesus in our lives, let's join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ invites you to a place of honor at this banquet. Welcome to the feast. You may be seated. The ushers will invite you forward. We'll begin at the outer wings and make your way down the center aisle. If you want to stop and pray after you've received communion at the altar rail, you're welcome to do so. If you want to remember your baptism at the font as you come to communion, you're welcome to do so. If you can't come forward, we will serve you as soon as we can.
Thank you.
Rise with me, please. May this body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen and keep us in faith, hope, and love, here, everywhere, now, and forever, in Jesus' name. Amen. Pray with me. O God, as a mother comforts her child, so you comfort your people, carrying us in your arms and satisfying us with this food and drink, the body and blood of Christ. Send us now as your disciples, announcing peace and proclaiming that the reign of God has come near through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord's face shine upon us with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. Amen. Our concluding medley, One Nation Under God. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a disgrace to any people. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord.